Hello boys and girls. In this video, I kind of give an overview of various representations of rotations in three-dimensional space. I even made this cardboard coordinate system that I will put to use soon. This is really just a cornflakes box. I talk about rotations, but really this is a discussion about Lie-algebra, Lie group correspondence in disguise. It's kind of a special case. And I want to focus in particular about the axis angle representation and rotation axis for computing rotations of objects in three-dimensional space. And I will also talk quite a bit about rotation matrices and a little bit about quaternions, less so about Euler angles, but Rodriguez formula will be part of this video, and very explicit calculations, and in the end also like displaying in the real world that things work out. I'm verifying a bunch of formulas, you might say. This video is kind of a precursor as well for the video I want to do this week still on this book, Topics in Non-Commutative Algebra, A Theorem of Campbell, Baker, Hausdorff, and Dynkin. This book is by Bonfiglioli and Fulci. And this is all about the Baker, Campbell, Hausdorff formula, or the Dynkin formula. And this video kind of motivates one of the cases why this is an important formula, or why we would be interested in the result that it gives. So, okay, on Wikipedia there are a million pages dedicated to rotations. It's basically not just that for every kind of subtopic, there is its own Wikipedia page, but I would say the information is also not very organized. It's like things are repeated often. I guess it's difficult with so many people to organize this topic, which has so many facets. Here's the page on the axis angle representation for rotations, and we will come across this formula in this video. We will talk about an exponential function. This is the way in which kind of the Lie-algebra, Lie group correspondence comes into play. These kind of formulas we will see, then how to convert between the different representations for two and three-dimensional cases of rotations. This video relates to videos I did previously on Lie algebra theory, quaternions, where I talk a lot about rotations. I have some long-ish videos on quaternions there. They will pop up in this video as well. And for a more physical perspective, I talk about rotation axis. I make use of them also in the video where I talk about the moment of inertia tensor and matrix. The Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula. I will not touch this in this video per se, but you will immediately see how the exponentials come in, and as well as the logarithms, at least in the case of finite dimensional matrices. And after this video, there will be quite a hands-on interpretation of the kind of objects that are involved here. For that sake, I finally have written down. I've made a Flask Python server, so I can actually do these notes in proper LaTeX. Here we would see this the same document as just a plain text file. So I will make use of that probably a lot in future videos as well. These are I just browse through it quickly. These are the things that we will discuss in this video, so it will probably be an hour. So here you see quaternions and a bunch of matrices, rotation matrices, and then the example that I will also describe in physical terms. So let me not even go too much into the resources. Usually, in a lazy fashion, I just list Wikipedia articles. Of course, there's also books and other web pages. But just as a reference, you'll find all these references in the box below. rotation matrices in two dimensions will show up, in three dimensions these kind of formulas will mention in passing, and here again this kind of equations that we already saw will kind of explain their use. And really the fact that this works, this kind of passing between different representations for rotations, as we will use it now, goes back to this Euler's theorem, the Euler's rotation theorem. Let me just read this sentence. In geometry, Euler's rotation theorem states that in three-dimensional space, any displacement of a rigid body such that a point on the rigid body remains fixed, or one point remains fixed, is equivalent to a single rotation about some axis that runs through the fixed point. So while you know the matrix, like since you often work with that, you know that given a any rotation in space, there must be some corresponding matrix that represents that, or that acts on vectors in three-dimensional space and that implements this kind of rotation. This theorem from 1775 states that for every rotation that you might do, there is also a corresponding axis of rotation and just one angle, so that the whole rotation is described by just rotating along that axis. So let me start here with this example that I will come back to later at the end. We will calculate it through. So I have here my coordinate system, right? Let's say, how do I hold it? Let's fix the convention right now. So let's say blue is the z axis, points upwards, as I hold it here. Then the one going towards you is the x axis, the orange one. So x, z, and y is the yellow one. And I have here some object that I will rotate, the scissors here. I take the scissors because they have this kind of peculiar shape, and flat on one side. And then they have these two holes, but the holes on these particular scissors are different, so you can easily see it. So, like it's clear, like as far as we talk about axis of rotation, that there you can just take the standard coordinate system, you know, literally this three axis, and see them as rotation axis. And in that sense, it's clear what happens if you rotate some object along this axis, right? So. Let me start out with the object aligned along the z axis the way you see it. So yeah, I kind of pin it to this axis. So the flat side is in the z y plane. And so let me perform two rotations in sequence. First, I will rotate. By the way, I will always take also this rotation convention, you know, for the direction in which I rotate. If I like take the axis like this with my hand, then I will rotate along my finger. So, like for example, if I rotate by 90 degrees along the y axis, so the y was this yellow one here, right? So I would take the axis like this. Rotation goes forward, so the rotation by 90 degrees along the y-axis is moving the scissors forward, so I end up like this. And then after this rotation along the y-axis, I do a rotation along the z-axis, right? So this is the z-axis, this is going to be the rotation direction, so another 90 degrees, so I rotate it and it moves over like this, right? Okay, so at the end of rotating along y and then z, the object is like with the long axis of the object in parallel with the y axis itself, and the object is also flat, like the flat side is in the xy plane, right? So let me repeat that maybe. First along the y axis, so this is this forward motion, then set, and then I'm in this kind of position. Okay, this the, you know, if I change these two rotations together, I have another rotation, but this rotation is not the same as just starting out, this is the original position again, and rotating in one or the other direction along the x-axis, right? So like if this is the positive rotation axis, then this would be like negative 90 degrees along the x-axis. If I do that, like from the starting position 90 degrees, then I end up like this. And this is another position, obviously, right? Because now the scissors are not flat, but the two holes are pointing towards them in the way that you can see them. So, you know, if I start out and rotate around the x axis, I get this position where you can see the holes. If I do y first and then z, then I get to another position. So basically the difference is just that this is turned around, right? Clearly I go from this situation to this situation, right? The object itself gets rotated, like not just around the x-axis, but also around this axis, you know, it's their own like axis, long axis of the object. But now we come back to the theorem. The theorem says that any rotation, including in effect this rotation, has an axis corresponding to the rotation itself, such that the rotation, you know, this rotation that I do, you know, along two axes, is given by just one axis. So there is somewhere an axis here, so that if I wrote this object around this axis, then I end up here. And the question now is, where is this axis, right? The axis is not one of this three axes, because we already know what happens with an object if you rotate around one of these three axes. So, you know, if you rotate around y, it does this. If you rotate, you know, or this in the other direction, if you rotate around just the set axis from the start, then it would just turn like this. If you rotate around the, you know, I don't know what I already did, y would be that, x would be this kind of rotation. But none of those is the same rotation that I get from doing these in sequence, right? So what is the axis? How does the axis lie? How can I compute it? We're going to show you in this video how you can compute this axis. But spoiler, the axis that corresponds to this combined rotation is, here just this pen, is the one that sticks out in this direction. So, okay, let me, like in terms of coordinates, would be easier if I have a computer animation, but basically if you go up one unit in Z, you go in the positive direction in Y, and then one in the negative direction in X. So there's this the axis that we want to get at lies like going backward diagonally into this sector. So if I rotate this object, that you can see how it looks like from all sides, right? Okay, so this is basically going back in x direction, positive in y direction, and positive in z direction. This is actually the axis that corresponds to the rotation that you get from those. So if I rotate the scissors around this axis here, right? Then, I mean, I don't know if you can see it well, but what happens is that this object rotates like so and makes this turn, and this is how the final position comes about, right? So combining this rotation around the y-axis and this rotation around the z-axis, you get the kind of position that you also get by rotating around this axis that goes through the coordinate system like this. And we're going to compute this, and you will see the numbers. But this is exactly actually also what the Baker-Kemper-Hausdorff formula also does implicitly three times three rotation matrices, because the x and y, these are x and y, capital X and capital Y, are names for some elements of the Lie algebra, and they are in a very simple direct correspondence with the rotation axis. And then taking the exponential of these Lie algebra objects gets you to the Lie group, to the transformation. And so this basically says that Z is the, what is Z? What is the Lie algebra element that corresponds to the combined transformation on the Lie group level? So this Z is this kind of axis we search for in a way. I mean, this for the 3x3 rotations, there's X, Y, and Z objects here. By the way, these are not, these X, Y, and Z, not to be confused, these letter names with the coordinate axes themselves, right? For the 3x3 rotation matrix, so if E to the power of X is a rotation matrix, a matrix with 9 components, then X itself also has 9 components, some of which will be 0, but nonetheless. And these are matrices we're working with. So we still have to do one small step to get from the X matrix to the axis vector in this case. But it's a little step. Nevertheless, you can think of the Lie algebra element, in at least in this rotation case, as the generator of the rotation, which is in correspondence with the angle axis, basically the axis, as well as how far you have to go. So, for example, in the case of this rotation down here around this invisible axis there, I think the rotation is by 2 pi divided by 3, so 1/3 of a total circle. So if you would do, if you would go one rotation and then another one, you would end up somewhere here, and then a third one, and then you would be back. But okay, so this is the visualization. And now let's go to the text through which we will work through. So okay, as I said, I here just posted a bunch of links that will lead you to a bunch of formulas and a little bit messed up Wikipedia articles as I described. There's a lot of duplicated information, but in particular in these links is also there's some physics coming in, but also a lot more talk about quaternions that I will mention but not discuss in much detail. I will not prove anything about quaternions in this video. Also in this video, I will not talk about the Euler angles, which gives a way of splitting any rotation into three smaller, easier to describe rotations. I will mention it in passing. I will point to some matrix representations that relate to it. But the focus is here really on the axis angle and rotation axis vector. Okay, so for starters, we will need that if you have a matrix, then in all the good cases, you can take the exponential of it. So you basically just take the matrix A and do the definition of the series as is given here, and you compute this. And by the way, I see I have some, I switched around with notations a little bit, so this is a little bit messed up. Let me quickly fix that. Here is a B and here is an H. So. In a similar way to taking X of A, is any matrix in our case here. You can also take the logarithm of M, although the logarithm, as you know, is not defined everywhere. So also with matrices, this doesn't always work out. So for example, if M is this kind of matrix with a negative value here, and this is a diagonal matrix, then you cannot, like, you, at least you don't stay in the real numbers if you take the logarithm of this kind of matrix. But this is just a side note. Of course, if you take any of these infinite series, and you always have to check out if the domains and codomains mostly work out. But I will obviously not dwell too much on it in this video. I will want to describe the rotations. So we always talk about the situation where it works, but good thing is no dangerous things really happen in this video. Okay, and so as with the note on the Baker-Campbell-Hauser formula, think of the image of the X function as the group element, the transformation, and the argument of it, the Lie-algebra element. Basically here, I will end up talking about rotations and skew-symmetric matrices, which correspond to the rotation matrices. And I will talk about rotation matrices and the axis vectors. But I will use the more generalized nomenclature, like Lie group element, Lie algebra element, and the correspondence should then be clear. The group element is always a transformation, the full transformation, that has representations as actions of transforming objects in space. And the algebra element doesn't have the group multiplication on the objects themselves, but they each generate a transformation. Okay. Without loss of generality, if G is some matrix and theta is some real number, then if I just plug in this formula that I have here, I get this kind of thing. And I do this just so that I have this parameter that steps through various transformation elements. If I go from 0 to 1 here, then for example, then the transformation goes from the identity transformation, the do nothing transformation, to whatever x of g is. I also don't know why I wrote h again here. Then, roughly speaking, taking the x is easier, like it's in more cases more well defined. So if you take the x of g, then you will be able to take the log in the other direction again, as I said above. This this is assuming that the logarithm of g even exists, but okay, last comment on that. Okay, and just as a note, if I have this theta multiplied by this matrix, and this is a new matrix, and take it to the power of n, then this basically, this line basically just says that the basic analysis, basic calculus really, that one knows from school also, like passes forward to this matrix situation. And I mean, we're just in linear algebra, right? It's not very, very dangerous. So this happens so that if you take the derivative of this x function, then you can follow along with this, what happens here. And eventually, just with the normal like one-dimensional exponential function, the whatever you have here in the exponent that is not the parameter just pops out, right? And so this means, for example, that if you take the derivative at zero of the group element, so this is the group element, then this g pops out. The e to the power of the zero matrix is just the identity matrix, so you can compute the g, that I call it g for generator, the Lie algebra element, by taking the derivative of the group element, trajectory of the group element that is given by this expression at zero. Okay, this is just facts to get us started. Here comes the first example, and this is the example of the two-dimensional, the rotations in two dimensions. This is a nice case because this is just a one parameter case and you can do basically all calculations by hand. So let's say A is given by theta times J, and J is this simple anti-symmetric, basically a normalized, if you will, anti-symmetric matrix in two dimensions. In In two dimensions, the anti-symmetric matrices, they must have zero on the trace, and the off diagonal element, like zero on the diagonal, and the off diagonal elements must be the inverse, additive inverse of each other. So there is, you know, really not much you can do in this sense. This is normalized in the sense that I demand this J has a one here, and these are A that we are going to work with. Then really this J is a two-dimensional representation of the imaginary unit, right? Because if you do a matrix multiplication and multiply the J with itself, you get minus the identity. Here this I 2 times 2 denotes the two-dimensional identity matrix. And then J to the power of 3 is just J times J to the power of 2, and we already computed that, so this is that. And then if you take the power of 4, then it's just the identity matrix squared, which is the identity matrix. So yeah, here we go. Okay. Yeah, and because of that, it's easy, like just with abstract algebra, basically, to compute this analysis object, the exp, the matrix exponential series of this theta times j. You know, it's given by this expression with these four rules that we just found, or three rules really. And then we can collect the coefficients and see, oh, this is just the cosine and the sine. And you know, this is might be basic here, but I point this out because we will see basically the same kind of scheme with the higher dimensions then as well, in the three-dimensional case. This is where the strange ugly formulas pop up. But if you have some intuition in the two-dimensional case, then you can know what you were to expect, and then it's simpler. Yeah, so we found out that exp of theta times j is just the rotation matrix as you know it. And you know, here I explicitly did all the steps. So that's nice. And moreover, here we can also not just because of the fact that we abstractly just stated for the exponential series, but we can actually by hand go in and take the derivative of this object, of this rotation RJ that I call it by theta. Namely, if we take the derivative, well, we take the derivative of each of these matrix elements, we evaluate them at zero, and then we find that this is this matrix. And, well, this is just J. So in two ways now we derive this fact. And then what happens in this two-dimensional case, and this is special to the two-dimensional case, is that this generator, generator without the theta, is actually itself a rotation matrix as well, right? Because if you plug in pi over 2, so 90 degrees, then the cosine is 0 there, so the diagonal is 0, and the sine is 1, so J also happens to be a rotation. But this is a special case. This is a special case where for this Lie group, the two-dimensional rotation group, the element happens to be also the same as one of the objects you get if you take the exp. So this also makes sense, right? Because if you have a round object, I happen to have one here. So let's say we have this orange, and this is the center, and you have any here is let's say my finger here is a vector, like from the center to the tip of my finger, and you apply the transformation, let's say in time, and rotate this thing like a clock around the orange, then the tangent vector of the tip of my finger as it moves around is naturally always tangential to the circle, right? So if this is the hand of the clock and it's moving like this, then the tangent of the tip is like the derivative of the tip, the velocity is always tangential to the clock itself, right? And so indeed, if you take the derivative of the object as you just start rotating it, right, then the, again, if this is the center and this is the object, if it moves like this, then the tangent vector is like that orthogonal to the thing itself. Okay, I'm not sure if my playing around with my fingers here helps too much, but in any case, you also see it algebraically. The derivative of this object that you rotate is given by taking the object and just rotating it. Like the velocity vector is given from the object itself by rotation. Maybe I shouldn't have called this the vector here v, because it's not meant to be here the velocity. Even though the whole thing is the velocity of this, so maybe let's call me actually. Let's write. Where am I? Let's write x here. Just as a side note, so here I have this kind of server that translates this text to LaTeX. I might make a video also about the whole this server and this model. You know, it's just 200 lines of Python, not even, to make that, because I think it's pretty handy. So I don't have to write LaTeX files and compile them all the time, and I can on the fly recompile them. Okay, and okay, let me for completeness right here x. Okay, so and moreover, like with this also a special case, at least, no, I mean, a special case in a broader context of Lie groups, although we will see the formula also for the three-dimensional rotation group, the formula that follows, namely the following: given the rotation, you know, this is just this rotation here. Then if you take it and subtract the transpose of it, since this cancels out the diagonal naturally, right? So we have the cosines in the diagonal, but if you flip the matrix that transpose it, then the diagonal stays the same. Then you subtract it, it kills off the diagonal elements. And since for this matrix here, the off-diagonal elements also inverses of each other, right? So this is just added together. And so if you then cancel out this element sine and also divide by 2, because you get a 2 by subtracting this, then you find that this is just this matrix, which is just theta times j. So this is actually the generator that we use to get to the rotation matrix. So it turns out that if you compute this object here, you know, it's an algebraic operation. You transpose the matrix and then you divide some stuff out, some scalar. Then you get actually the generator, which is as we defined the inverse of the exp. So this is the logarithm. So in this case, for the rotation matrix, you can compute the logarithm, which is a priori given as an infinite series, quite easily, which is nice. And we will then also see then how this plays out in three dimensions. Yeah, and here we're already in the three dimensional case. So in the three dimensional case, we have suddenly infinitely many rotation axes, basically. So in the two dimensional case, you can say there's one rotation axis coming out of the plane. Or you say that there's just no rotation axis at all. It's just, you know, it's just one-dimensional motion. But in a three-dimensional case, S is clear because it's, you know, a three-dimensional Lie group. It has infinitely many elements, but also they are not reached just by moving along one parameter like we had before. Previously, in the two-dimensional case, we had just this one theta, and if you go with theta from 0 to to pi, then you go once in a circle and you have all the rotation elements. You cannot do this here in the because in the manifold sense at least you have these three different dimensions. You know, don't want to get into arguments about cardinality and like some non-smooth parameterization that you could capture the object in just with one real parameter, but in the manifold sense that you can smoothly move through the space of all rotations of all transformations. This is three-dimensional. So I will explicitly only do one example, namely the one where I define A to be one parameter. There are, to describe the full space of rotations, you need three real parameters. But here in my example, I speak about one rotation, and this is a super simple one. Namely, the rotation is going to be generated, you know, in the sense that we just talked about with exponentiating some Lie-algebra element with this matrix Z, given with mostly zeros, but then two elements which are non-zero. This is also an anti-symmetric matrix, a skew-symmetric matrix, in the same way J was. And so if you compute that, then, well, you know, since the exponential function of zero is one, and since this is, we can separate this matrix into blocks, we can easily compute the exponential of that, knowing the two-dimensional case that we just did by hand. So RZ turns out to be this thing. And what is that? Well, this is a transformation or like a rotation by an angle theta around the Z axis. So if we take this example and we have any object here, what's a good object? Yeah, the book here, hovering, then rotating the book, for example, this would be like rotating it around the Z axis would be a rotation realized by this 3 times 3 rotation matrix. And so we already see that this I mean, obviously I call this matrix Z because it corresponds to a rotation eventually around the Z axis, around the third axis there, in this rotation matrix representation. I mean, here are a lot of zeros there because it's this rotation is kind of tuned towards the coordinate system that already set up. The rotation around the one of the major axes, the standard axis, will always be quite simple. That's why I choose it as an example. So it's not like this kind of the one rotation that has this axis, as I alluded to, the one that goes into this backward sector. That will be a more complicated rotation that is given by, like, also given by two of the simple rotations, and we are going to eventually then end up computing that. But before we go there, I will like now throw a bunch of truths on your head, and I hope they will be very believable given what we already saw. So in general, given a rotation, I call this RA here. So to say, there's this rotation matrix A, and there's this rotation matrix R, and A is the corresponding generator. So R ought to be the exponential of A. And as I already said, rotations have three independent dimensions, and you can parameterize now rotations in various ways, and this is also what we're kind of going to do. And there would be Euler angles, a rotation vector that I'm going to talk about. But also, if you look at the quaternions, which, as I had described in previous videos, are like even in the previous videos, I even talked with very general fields, didn't even talk about real number representations. But the smallest representation is then given by 2 times 2 matrices or 4 dimensions. And some of them, as I also explained in this video, and I actually show how this comes about in that video with the general field, but some of these quaternions also correspond to rotations, and these are exactly the quaternions that have a quaternion norm of 1. And so in this four-dimensional space of quaternions, there's a subspace of three dimensions, and all these are also rotations. So this is also one of the representations, so next to Euler angle rotation vector and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, okay, this is just a name. That's how I set up what A is. It ought to be the generator for this R. I have done this in the two examples previously as well. I always split up the theta, the how far the angle is to rotate. I split it from this here from the set and from the J, simply so I get an object which has a lot of ones and has nice algebraic properties like those. I do the same here with K. So K will be a 3x3 matrix. It is skew-symmetric, and this is, I didn't even write it down because this is something you always learn as soon as you learn about rotation matrices and the matrix exponential, right? The rotation matrix has the property that the transpose is also the inverse, and then as soon as you believe that you can actually, the logarithm series on this rotation matrix actually converges to a number, so as soon as you believe there's this kind of generator, then it's easy to show from the property of the rotation matrix that the generator must be a skew-symmetric object. And so this K is skew-symmetric, so it has three independent components. In principle, but I now also normalize this K matrix in the sense that I demand that this K vector, so these are three of these components, ought to be have norm 1, right? So the K is a three-dimensional vector, but it has only two free components because the other one is determined by this norm condition. And the third parameter that makes for the three-dimensional space that characterizes the generator is then this theta angle that I divided out. Okay, so in that way, it's without loss of generality. And I also define this vector VA, which is this unit vector, okay, it's a unit vector by this relation, and has norm theta, right? So this vector V points in the same direction as K and has length that is actually the value of theta, so something between, for rotation, something between 0 and 2 pi. And as you might guess, the K vector is going to be exactly parallel to the rotation axis that I talked before. So in this way, the generator, in a very straightforward fashion, like this matrix element, the skew-symmetric elements, I put it in very straightforward fashion with axis and rotation vectors, in the sense that the norm of V will be the exactly correspond also to the rotation angle that this K matrix or this A matrix induces. Another notation for this capital K would be to say this is the same linear transformation. I mean, it's obviously a linear transformation because it's a matrix. It's the same linear transformation as if you it acts the same way as if you do multiply from the right, if you multiply from the left with the cross product with K. So at the action of capital K on any vector W would be the same as taking the cross product of lowercase k and W. Okay. This is, I mentioned this already in the video about the rigid body moment of inertia where this plays a role in integrating out a bunch of degrees of freedom and being left only with the angular velocity, where the physical aspect of the whole spiel comes in. Okay. Then there's this theorem by, is this, I think I wanted to write Euler. I also often confuse who of them is older. I'm never sure if who was the pupil of the other one, but I think Gauss was first. I think Gauss was the young one, right? Euler was first and Gauss was the super early childhood genius. Well, I mean, both are geniuses, obviously, but I think Gauss is especially famous for being a very young genius. Anyway, the Wikipedia article that I already read out is exactly this sort of theorem that we have here. This Euler's rotation theorem is a theorem that the rotation about an angle theta and the rotation matrix is about an angle and the rotation matrix is parallel. The rotation axis should this, sorry. Good. So this is the statement, and now without the proof of that, I tell you what the relation is between the actual rotation matrix and this vector k that I just described as the being along this rotation axis. And namely, the rotations or any rotation is given like so. So you see cosine of the theta, and then the components of this k, you know, ka is just this k vector, and then here's an x component, here's a y component, here's a z component, and so on. So basically all these rotations look like that, and then, you know, you can pluck this a little bit apart, you pull out the cosines that are always on the diagonal and the sine which are here on the off diagonal with the sines, and you get then this expression, and this here is exactly this k matrix. This is the matrix that matrix representation of the cross product, and this object here, if you look at it for a second, is exactly this outer tensor product k times k. So, you know, you say here's k squared, and in here the a's are all here, and then the a's are also here. So this is just, you know, like component-wise multiplications in each field, so every rotation matrix is really just cosine times a unit matrix, then sine times this k matrix. So I want to highlight that these first two terms is really the same as what we had here, except the previously we had this J matrix, which just has one minus one in the off diagonal elements, and now we have basically quite literally a whole sphere of J matrices. Like basically for every K vector, which is a normalized vector, so this is a normalized three dimensional vector, so it's a vector on a sphere. In any whatever direction this K vector points the rotation axis, you get a matrix K, which is the analogy of the J. And then also in this three-dimensional case, we also have this extra term, and this is basically like what I could have also written here. Maybe we have it in, let's see. So this is basically this formula here. This is also then the Rodriguez formula action. Okay, this is exactly this kind of, it's more here. Okay, so So I could not, of course, scan through all these Wikipedia articles to find the right formula. But what I want to get at is that this matrix can also be expressed then in terms of the generator K. So it's basically the squared term of the K matrix. And if you can think of it that way, in the two-dimensional case, you also have this term, the sine term, and the in the two-dimensional case, of course, you have only one cosine term, right? And this is that because basically the last term here and the first term collapse in the one-dimensional and the two-dimensional case, where there's just no wiggle room. There you just have the identity matrix and the J matrix, and here you have more wiggle room and with this K vector, and so the first and the last component collapse together, especially so to speak. I mean, you can take the example that we just described here, this one, which is so very similar to the one-dimensional rotation, it's a two-dimensional matrix representation and a one-dimensional group, the rotation around two axes, and here you have basically also a representation of the two-dimensional rotation, right? Except that I also explicitly carry along this third axis. Okay, in any case, you can try to apply this scheme to our example just now, and then you will see how things collapse. Good. So if you take the trace here, this is just the square of the K vector, right? And we said that this ought to be normalized. So the trace of this is just one. And then if you take the trace of the trace of this is zero, obviously, and the trace of the unit matrix is three. So if you take the trace of the R matrix and subtract one, then you're just left with the cosine, and then you do, two cosines. So in this way, if you have the R matrix, you can easily compute the angle. And also you can easily compute the K matrix by taking the logarithm, of course. And from that, you also get the K vector, because the K vector is just three of the components of the K matrix, right? And here we can also see that this trick with the algebraic operation still works, because if this matrix and this matrix are symmetric, so if you compute R minus R transpose, they will be zero. And here you have an anti-symmetric matrix, so this is just two times R. Then you cancel the two out. And then you also cancel this sign out, and you're left with K, right? You can, like, as soon as you believe that this kind of representation is one of the representation, like the general representation for a general rotation matrix, then you can compute the axis, the direction of the vector, of the unit vector, and the angle. Okay, and just as a side note, because I thought I wanted to be a little bit more complete here, now we have also the quaternions. And if you want to see how quaternions represent rotations in three-dimensional space, then I do that in this or in this video. I think I do it here, because here you see this exact sequence formula that I put on the caption. The quaternions are basically, like, it's immediate when if you look at the representation of how the quaternions actually enable you to do rotations. But basically, look at it like this. Here we have a unit vector K, right? And so this is a unit vector that points, if this is a coordinate system, for some rotation, the unit vector, let's say, points in this direction here. How do you describe the components of this? Well, you can also describe the components of this unit vector by taking a unit vector that is aligned with an axis and then rotating it around, right? For example, this way you get this. So the components of this unit vector K, whatever it is, will have also already some sines and cosines in it if you make it explicit. So let me shortly see. do I have here? Yeah, okay. So here we will find other representations of the rotation matrices. Let me see. Okay, yeah, here. I will get to that in a second, but for example, you can also decompose this. Okay, let's see now. You can take a rotation and decompose it into free rotation. So a general rotation. It's not just given by the rotation along one axis. This is what this video is about. But you can also decompose this into exactly three rotations that are rotations around particular angles, and there also Euler angles come into play, or various other angles that are, you know, always defined from the coordinate system that you transform to. So it gets a little messy, but in any case, so what you see here is that rotation matrix is basically a conglomerate of a bunch of sines and cosines. In any case, that's one way of representing it, right? So this looks quite messy here. And the quaternions are basically the most efficient way to disentangle these rotation matrices and be left with an object, the quaternion Q, where each component is, roughly speaking, fewer trigonometric functions. So there might just be sines and cosines in it. And therefore, you know, when you apply a quaternion to a rotation, then you have to add from the left and right with quaternions, because you have to still have to get all these sines and cosines in. So in the application, these kind of multiplications have to get back. But the nice thing is that as long as you're just working with chaining together rotations, then you're working with these objects which don't have all these sines and cosines. So it's basically a reduced kind of representation. You also don't have nine components, but you just have four. Okay. You know, quaternions, four-dimensional, as described in the other video. And here we say, okay, a k-vector is, we take the same components that we had before, but now our basis vectors are not, you know, free vectors, like abstract vectors, on which we define maybe inner product or something like that. But here we already are in the representation. At least that's how we get it. You know, in this video, as you see, I just talk in terms of matrix representations. When I'm speaking about these objects, I'm already always in the representation. You don't have to do that for everything, but that's how I approach it here. And so if the EI, this is not the exponent, this is just the indices. If these three small e's are the three of the standard basis for representing the quaternion algebra, then the sum of these basis vectors multiplied by some number will also be a 2x2 matrix, right? So the K is also a 2x2 matrix, because the basis vectors are represented by 2x2 matrices. The K values are the same. And then, if I define then, this is, the, of course, you know, since a quaternion is just an algebra, it's a vector space, the object theta times K, where K is a 2x2 matrix, is also just a quaternion, of course, right? So a generic quaternion looks like so. My generic quaternion is called QB here. This is a coefficient of the zero basis vector. This is the identity matrix. And then some generic QA. This is this object here. What we get is that if I define QR as the exponent of this QA, in analogy to what we did the whole video, this is defined as the Taylor series, but this then also by the same tricks as we did in the one-dimensional case, where this object squared to minus one and so on and so forth. This is also the property, the defining property of the generating elements of the quaternion algebra. So we get the same formula, not too surprisingly, maybe. And And then finally, the then from here, so then also very easy to see that if you take a general QB and exponentiate it, then you get this object with the sine and cosine and sine times this scale factor, a to the power of this a. And so the quaternions, I don't, explicitly describe the action of the quaternions on three-dimensional objects here, but if you have this representation, and you can quickly see that the quaternions that have norm, and this is supposed to be the quaternion norm here, those which have norm one are those quaternions that correspond to rotations. These are representations of the rotations. Okay, and as I kind of motivated, what's special here is that quaternion representation is very compact. And so what is maybe a little bit confusing is that the representing object of the Lie-algebra, right? The A quaternion, this object basically, or this object here, as well as the transformation object, the QR, but this was the algebra object, and this was the transformation object. They are extremely similar, basically. If I give you a quaternion, then it's it's not like with the rotation matrices where I say, oh, if I take the transpose of it and if it inverts, then I know it's a rotation, and if I take the transpose of it and it flips the sign, then it's the skew-symmetric matrix. So this is the algebra element. And with the quaternions, you also have the distinction. The A quaternions, the generating quaternions, are those which have zero component. They just have spatial components. And the rotation quaternions, the QRs, are special in that their norm is one. They have a zero component, but the norm is one. So there is a bounding condition to kill this fourth dimension off in both cases, and there are different conditions. But nonetheless, in both cases, you deal with these two objects, and people tend to be confused then. Also without proof, but it's also, we find it in various places in the Wikipedia articles. If you have this quaternion QA, and so there's a bunch of these spatial components, here they are given by here I just copied the notation from the Wikipedia page. So the first component would be I, the second component would be J, and the third component would be K, I guess, and R probably the last one. Oops. Sorry, I think this is the QR. I have to look it up. I just edit this here. I just remove this because I didn't see that they have four components. And okay, let me write it like this. Okay, QR. Come on. Yeah, I'm just proving to myself that I'm very relaxed and take the time to edit mid-video. Okay. Yeah, so. But I mean, again, I have the links in the box and also on top of this file here. So that's, again, how you get how you get from this representation to the R representation, right? So these are going to be, you will have this cosinus theta there in any case. And so this is how you get back. And so here you also see kind of the square nature of it, right? While the representation of the action of the quaternions on the object is given by this left and right multiplication with quaternions, and there is where you get the square of the quaternion, so to speak. If you go to the 3x3 linear representation, then you have to do the squaring already in the R matrix. Yeah, and this is what I alluded to also in the in this this link where you already saw, oh, there's three angles, also particular angles and particular axes. The axes are actually just the standard axis. So there is for every rotation, similarly to like basically this is now coming from the other direction. Given the object transformation from here to here, then there is a way using all three standard axes to get from there to there. And in this case, we already know that this is 0 rotation around the Z axis, then 90 degrees around the Y axis, and 90 degrees around the X axis. So in this example, this just happens to be alpha, happens to be 0, so this falls away, it's just identity matrix, and then by these two transformations I get this transformation which flips over there. Okay, and we will actually get now to this example again and actually do the calculation. So yeah, we already have the oh, but let me see. Sorry. Yeah, so we take the rotation around the Z axis and do the, as I just said, the rotation by pi divided by 2, so by 90 degrees. So Rz of pi half is this matrix. Yeah? We just take the matrix above and plug in the theta value. We get this object. So the corresponding A matrix is the angle times set. So set again, I mean, I've just split this example basically in two parts, but here is already set given and R given, and we plug in this theta value, we get exactly these two things. So by picking out the right components, as I've written above, so I've written here that given, sorry for scrolling around so much, given A or K, then if you take these components, you have A32, this is the one in the lower middle, then 1, 3, this is the one in the top right corner, and then 2, 1. So given this component, and this component, this gives us our rotation vector, right? So this is exactly this vector, and I can pull out the pi half. And so indeed, any rotation around the Z axis, so this was this, you know, rotation around of the book around the Z axis. This rotation by 90 degrees is along an axis, the upwards axis, that is parallel to this vector 0, 0, 1, and the norm of the vector is exactly this 90 degrees angle. And here EZ denotes the basis vector along the Z axis. Okay, and now finally to our starting example. You know, what we do here is, again, we rotate first around the Y axis and only then around the Z axis. So the rotation by 90 degrees around the Y axis happens to be this matrix. And this is also very easy to see because, well, the Y component is left invariant by the by rotation, right? So this is why here's a Y. Like, imagine here is this matrix applied to a vector that is the unit vector in the Y direction, 0, 1, 0. Then applying this leaves it invariant. In fact, it's an eigenvector. And this is generally the case naturally, that the rotation vector for a rotation matrix is always its eigenvector, because the rotation angle is exactly the angle that around which it's being rotated, so the rotation angle doesn't change itself. We can do this explicitly. So this is the rotation we talk about here, right? This along the Y by going forward by 90 degrees, so from here to here. Let's see what happens to all the basis vectors. So by this rotation, this is now a stand-in for a general basis vector. By this rotation, the this the basis vector in a set direction is tilted forward, so the set direction becomes the x direction, right? Which means that the vector 0, 0, 1 must become 1, 0, 0, right? So 0, 0, 1 applied to this, like this matrix applied to it becomes, the multiplication is exactly with this element here. So this becomes 1, 0, 0, so this works out. Similarly, the y, as we already said, is left invariant. And what happens to the x basis vector? Well, if this is rotated down, then the x basis vector becomes the minus z vector. It's turned down. So 1, 0, 0 must become 0, 0, minus 1. And this is exactly what this matrix does. So here we, like, just by looking at the basis vectors, also reconstruct what the rotation matrix is. On that note, there's also this cosine matrix representation of rotation matrix, which goes exactly along these lines. You basically just look at how the basis vectors are going to be mapped, and this way you also get the rotation matrix. Okay. So the rotation of the scissors forward and then to the left from my side on seeing from my side is the chain of this rotation matrix, the multiplication, right? So first around y, then around z. So we just have to multiply these matrices that we just computed. We multiply them together, we get this kind of thing. And then to find the axis, we must take the logarithm. Or as we know, we can do that by doing this r minus r transpose trick. So if we do that, compute also the angle, which if you remember is given by this formula, among other formulas. So we take the trace of the rotation matrix, we get the rotation matrix happens to be this with zero, so we have we need the angle of the cosine of the angle that we search for is 0 minus 1, so minus 1 half. Okay, now you can play around with your inverse cosine and, you know, type it into Wolfram alpha or something, and then you get the angle, and it happens to be then exactly pi divided by 3. Then 1 over square root of 3, because this is just what you need if you have a vector with a bunch of 1s. Which is what you get if you read the components of here, and then you want to normalize, because the k vectors are supposed to be normalized before you look at what the theta angle is, and then you get this kind of this object here. And then you find that the rotation vector is this rotation. This is 360 divided by 3, so it's literally 120 degrees. And this is this rotation here. And we just computed in which direction the axis looks like. So minus 1 in the negative direction of x, then 1 positive y and 1 positive z. So this is exactly how the vector must lie, the rotation vector along which we need to rotate to get the combined rotation. I hope that makes sense. I added here the matrix log function call that you can plug into Wolfram Alpha or so. And now finally, with that, we have this example. Glimpse at the next video. So the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula is exactly this kind of computation. So we said we have two transformations, in our case the forward and the sideways motion. We can compute what the generating element is, the Lie-algebra element, or which is basically the k vector times the theta angle. And then we know that these both individually generate a transformation, a rotation in this case. we can multiply the transformations and get another transformation. And the question then is, hey, what is actually the generating matrix or the generating rotating vector that gives exactly that rotation that you get by multiplying these two other rotations? And this is exactly here, this set. And the Dynkin formula that we will discuss in similarly in painful detail is how, like, the magic about it, the interesting aspect of it is that computing this set, you know, the logarithm of the multiplication of these exponentials here, is given, like, I mean, just this, in principle, you know how to compute, because both exp and log are given in terms of series expansions. So it will also be some series expansion with some powers of x and y. But the Dynkin formula then tells you that this set can actually be computed merely from looking at the commutators of x and y in the Lie-algebra. And then you get this pretty formula. And okay, I will cut it here. We will numerically verify this in the next video. So I hope this video was long, almost 1.5 hours, but I think it's a strong motivation for looking at this Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula and Dynkin's realization. Okay, take care.